The physicist Niels Bohr once said, "How wonderful it is that we have met with a paradox. Now we have some hope of making progress." So my name is Sui Huang. I'm a professor at the Institute for Systems Biology. And my research, in a nutshell, is to use the theory of systems, of complex systems, to apply to cancer research to bring in a new perspective to understand the fundamental principles that drive cancer and that governs why some cancers respond to therapy and others not. This differs a bit from a lot of what is going on in cancer research, which is now very much data-driven in the big data area. But we are very interested in theory. We still love data, and we think that theory without data is useless, and so is data without theory. And therefore, we need to have an approach that integrates data with theory. So now, why paradoxes? That's a very important question. And paradoxes have been suppressed in cancer research because they challenge paradigms and they're not good for business. But they play a very central role in understanding therapy. So a central paradox in cancer is that treatment often backfires. So the key term is backfiring. That means that while you give a drug or radiation, you shrink the tumor. But on the other hand, at the very same time, inseparably to the effect, to the beneficial effect, you also prepare the ground for the tumor to recur. And that means the therapy can actually promote tumor progression. So this is what we're going to talk about. And I think that understanding the mechanism for why cancer treatment can backfire opens a new avenue for therapy, for treatment, the untapped room for improvement, because what we have been doing so far is keep doubling down. So we have an ineffective therapy, and then we come up with more powerful ways of killing. That is what pharma has been doing. It's just this one-dimensional, linear thinking that we just need to double down. So we need to take a step back and think about these paradoxes. Now, the phenomenon of backfiring is, I think, well known to many of you, because that occurs when we deal with complex systems and try to manipulate something to our desire. For example, if you try to suppress a political opponent, or if we invade a country that has terrorists, all these political things have the potential that they backfire. We know that. But in cancer research, you haven't appreciated that so much. And these phenomenons, I think, is best summarized in the aphorism by Friedrich Nietzsche, who said, "What doesn't kill me makes me stronger." And so that's what tumor do, and we just need to kill the tumor without making it stronger. That's the new idea. And that's a very complex question, but the short answer is that you probably know from textbooks that people think cancer starts with a single cell that has some mutation that gives it a growth advantage and also affords it the feature of not considering the society of a cell of normal tissue, so it starts to proliferate autonomously without regard of normal tissue. Now that is a very simplistic view, and it's very driven by the notion that you need a mutation to change a cell into a malignant cell. A more complex picture can be summarized as viewing cancer as a village, and you all know it takes a village to grow something, right? And so it takes a village to grow tumors, meaning that it takes many, many different types of cells that have to collaborate and generate a dynamics to make that village grow to a city, and the city then also wants to grow and keeps expanding, and in doing so, also needs to extract resources from its environment and to manipulate its environment such that it can grow. That essentially what the tumor is, which means that we have to deal with a lot of kinds of cells in a tumor and a huge diversity of cells, of cancer cells and non-cancer cells, each of which will have a highly different response to any therapeutic intervention, and that is a problem. So it's not a homogeneous mass like you see in a cartoon, in textbooks. This is a deeply inherent property to any intervention that we perform to suppress any undesired complex additive system. I mentioned this backfiring of the war on terrorism and in coup d'etat, sanctions and so on. If we are not completely successful, and we rarely are, then the system that we try to suppress will respond in a way that our actions look like they backfire. And this phenomenon can be described in crisp mathematical terms, which we don't want to do here, but it has to do with non-linear dynamics of complex systems. Now, this mindset that you can just go and kill is still prevalent in cancer research. It is essentially a mindset that is based on a linear thinking of the tumor and of therapy being a zero-sum game, so that you go and you kill, and then if you kill only 80% of the cells, then you can come back later and use a more potent drug to kill off the remaining 20%. That's not how it works. Once you've killed 80% of the cancer cells, the entire tissue changes, the 20% or 10% or even 1% of tumor cells that survive will be different, because they also have seen the drug. They have undergone a near-death stress situation. If somebody undergoes a near-death stress situation, it changes one's life. And so are these cancer cells. They're completely different after therapy, even without mutations. So typically, this cell stress would push cells into a repair mode, and that is also called stem cells. The cells can divide because they think there's something going on and they want to repair. But this is a cancer cell, so it's an abnormal stem cell, an abnormal repair response, and we know these cells now as so-called cancer stem cells. So we create these cancer stem cells with therapy. They just stay there. We have shrunken the tumor, which is good, what you see in the CAT scan. But there's a little bit of tumor left, and that can be a danger. If you kill off every cancer cell, you're probably safe. It's like in a war on terrorism, you go in a country and very precisely kill off everybody who is a terrorist. But we rarely do that, so they are survivors, they are empowered, they respond. In the case of cancer cells, the two mechanisms by which a not 100% successful therapy will promote progression. One is, as I mentioned, at the level of individual cells, the cancer cell will become cancer stem cells. But then there's another mechanism that we just recently realized, and actually it's old knowledge, and that comes from a lot of work together with my long-time collaborator, Deepak Panigrahi, at the Harvard Medical School. And that is that when you kill a lot of tumor cells, what happens with the dead bodies of every single cell, every single cancer cell, dies and stays there. So in normal tissue, when cells die, they never die in these masses, but when they die, they get eaten up by specialized cells. But in the tumor, when we irradiate or kill with poisons a lot of cells, then this cell debris stays there and triggers an inflammation. Now, inflammation, as I mentioned, is part of the surrounding of tumors that can modify the course of cancer, and it can actually promote cancer. But inflammation is very complicated, and it's another double-edged sword, because there are two types of inflammation with respect to cancer. One type promotes cancer, as I just mentioned. These cells will come in and create an environment of making the tumor think there's more repair needed, but it's a pathological repair, and so on. And inflammation promotes tumor. But on the other hand, inflammation is also the first step of an immune response, and it can actually immunize or lead to the immunization of the body, activating immune cells, T cells mostly, that can fight the cancer. And so it's another double-edged sword, another situation where something can backfire, another paradox. And that's a very important question, because you hear now from people who are aware of this paradoxical effect whether they should undergo chemotherapy in the first place. And I think the answer is yes, because it's a very difficult decision, right? You have a beneficial effect, you shrink the tumor, you debulk the tumor, which is often needed, you reduce the tumor mass, which can have all the complications, you reduce the probability of spreading and so on. But on the other hand, you cause this damage, and you promote this chronic inflammation filled by this dead cells debris and by the stress that you apply to the tissue. So that fits really well, by the way, I forgot the picture that all pathologists have had for a long time, and that is that tumors, a tumor is like a wound that never heals. It is like a development that gets stuck in an immature state full of stem cells, and it's like a regeneration that never stops. So you have this inflammation locally, and the tumor is abnormal, abnormal stem cells, abnormal inflammatory cells. They don't know how to resolve the entire tissue and reconstitute a normal tissue state, which is a very sophisticated architecture. And so the whole thing promotes, and by adding injury to injury, it just essentially promotes a chronic inflammation, which is beneficial for tumor growth. So it's very hard to decide, but I would say one should undergo normal standard therapy to reduce tumor mass. And then, and that's a chance for improvement, we need to find ways to block all these mechanisms that I mentioned, that is the second edge of this double-edged sword, that would promote tumor progression if a tumor is under stress by therapy. And that is a part of our research. Again, inflammation is double-edged sword. Some people say we should promote inflammation by more chemotherapy in order to stimulate the immune system. And so we have these very complex nonlinear systems where at some point there's a tipping point and the system decides to go in either way, and it's very hard to decide. That's why we need more research in that, in the very specific details. One way is to reduce inflammation. I think that has worked pretty well. We know it because there are people who take baby aspirin for a very long time as a secondary prevention after heart attack, to prevent a second heart attack. And those people in some studies have a substantial reduced risk of cancer, in many cancers. Then there are people who try a soft killing. As I mentioned, this massive doubling down of trying to kill with more potent drugs might be wrong, so an alternative approach is not to use a traditional maximally tolerated dose that we do now, a very high dose of chemo to kill as many as possible of the cancer cells, but they use a minimally necessary dose to contain the tumor and prevent it to progress. And that, I think, is a good idea. For example, Bob Gattenby at the Moffitt Center in Cancer Center in Florida is doing this type of approach. It works only if you can very well monitor when the tumor shrinks and comes back. And then when the tumor shrinks, you stop it. And then comes back, you add again. So that's another way, using gentle killing. And again, the entire philosophy is that the tumor is like a sleeping giant. It's too risky to leave it sleeping. You want to kill it, but you might not be totally successful. And so a wounded, awoken giant is probably more dangerous than a sleeping giant, but it's very hard to make a decision. And therefore, all these new alternative methods to not to replace the killing, but to add additional ways to maintain the awakened giant, I think makes sense. So soft killing might be an option, reducing inflammation another. So inflammation can be pro-tumor or anti-tumor. And by the way, talking about curbing inflammation, aspirin, it sounds like it's a good thing, but it's actually also limited. Again, another double-edged sword, because aspirin at low dose can suppress all this inflammation that is going on, but it also has a danger of triggering bleeding because it's a blood thinner, essentially. And so, again, one way out of this conundrum, again involved with Deepak Panigrahi in Boston and others, is to find ways to benefit from this anti-inflammatory effect of aspirin without also having to accept that it can cause bleeding. And if we dissect the molecular pathways, then I think there are ways to do that. And that's actually active research going on here. Aspirin is a good example. Now, what we all also know is the many new ways that we have discovered for how aspirin works. It's not just blocking prostaglandins, which is a traditional thinking, but it also stimulates the synthesis of resolvins, which again is a work of Deepak in Boston together with Charlie Serhan, also in Boston. And that's a new molecule that can, the nice property that it promotes the removal of debris, it's anti-inflammatory, and it does not block the other good side of inflammation, which is the activation of the immune system. Now, for the body to make these resolvins, it can be promoted by aspirin, but aspirin needs a substrate, and one of the substrates for making resolvins is omega-3. Fatty acids, and that's probably one reason why omega-3 fatty acids are healthy for you, but I think it works best in conjunction with aspirin. It does. First, immunotherapy, it sounds romantic because you activate your own immune system, it kills cancer cells, but actually the immune system is very dangerous. It has always to be kept under control because also attack your own cells. And so one side effect is rare, it's manageable, of an immune therapy is the triggering of autoimmune diseases. But another one that I mentioned is, and I think that's underreported, is this acceleration of tumors by so-called checkpoint inhibitors, those that activate the immune system by removing or by blocking these natural checkpoints that the tumor co-opts in order to protect itself against the immune system. And so these checkpoint inhibitors have sometimes the effect in maybe 10 or even 20% of patients that they cause what is called a hyperprogression, so an acceleration of the tumor. We don't see that because those people are lumped together with the non-responders in the reports, right? But in animal experiments, you can see that because you can compare the animals with tumors that were treated with animals with tumors that were totally untreated. You cannot have that comparison with humans. But then we see that the treated but non-responding animals, mice, operate worse than the non-treated animals. So that is the issue we need to take care of. Again, another paradox, and it means that we have to dissect the mechanism in order to control just one side of this double-edged sword and have the other side have its effect.